Now is the winter of our discontent.
Wochenend und Sonnenschein und dann mit dir im Wald allein. Weiter brauch ich nicht zum glücklich sein. Wochenend und Sonnenschein.
Greetings, YouTube misfits, miscreants, malcontents, and misanthropes. Claire's here with her coffee. Come on in, grab yourself a cup and learn of the winter of my discontent. Why am I discontented, you may ask? Well, mostly it has to do with coffee with Claire, frankly. You see, with the elections over, with the state legislature of North Gubertania out of session, the number of truly wacky statements and actions by politicians has declined precipitously recently. Of course, there is John McCain, and we'll get to him later. But mostly, it's pretty quiet and it's pretty dull. And speaking of dull, there are the creationists. Having pwned them for a few years now, I find that they just repeat the same tired old things over and over and over and over. And I've just run out of creative and funny ways to explain polystrate trees and basic sedimentology. Igneous and metamorphic rocks, you name it. And they're boring me to sobs. And I find that recently my willingness to sit here and suffer fools has declined precipitously. My patience has worn thin. Fortunately, with regard to the ponage of well-known clownish buffoons like Eric Hovind or Ian Juby, there are people on YouTube who are picking up the slack, and one of them is my shout-out today, Mortimer81.
So, how exactly do you get a universe from nothing?
This should be fun.
By calling upon energy to be converted into matter, following the suit of Einstein's relativistic theory.
No, stop. Here's what he actually said. Krauss traces a series of discoveries building up from Einstein's general theory of relativity to the latest studies of dark energy, explaining how scientists have determined that empty space is seething with energy in the form of virtual particles. From the perspective of quantum physics, particles are popping into and out of existence all the time. The way Krauss and many other theorists see it, nothingness is so unstable that it has to give rise to something. In our case, the universe as we know it.
That's right! It can work! If we violate the laws of physics.
Who's talking about violating the laws of physics?
Now, despite the seething level of my discontent, I am continuing to work on ideas for the geodesy series, and my next video will be on hydraulic fracturing, commonly referred to as fracking.
The U.S. Geological Survey is now calling the Bakken Formation the largest continuous oil accumulation it's ever assessed.
For years, this oil has been unrecoverable, but they've come up with new technology.
Another good thing was the technology of this, the new frack technique.
Now, speaking of increasingly demented old John McCain.
John McCain has been embarrassing himself on national television, and it looks like he has no intention of stopping. To prove just how disconnected from reality this man is, McCain is now demanding UN Ambassador Susan Rice go on television and apologize for the way she characterized the Benghazi attacks.
John McCain has always been an arrogant prick, which is not an unusual failing for a U.S. senator. He sees himself relegated in the next Congress to the obscure Indian Affairs Committee, and he wants to remain relevant. Not to fear, John, to a segment of the American public, you'll always be relevant.
Confidence with Depend in Color, now available in gray. Looks and fits like underwear, same great protection. Depend. Good morning, great day.
And then there's lame duck Congressman Alan West of Florida, who finally conceded the election last week. And in keeping with the Alan West style that has endeared him to so many of us, his concession speech was a class act.
We're not going to go forth and contest the certified results that St. Lucie County sent up, even though they sent up the results based upon about a week ago Sunday and not the final recount. So we're going to move ahead, and we wish Congressman Murphy elect very well. But I think that now is not the time to try to draw a process out. We brought up some incredible voting irregularities, not just in St. Lucie County, but also some that we found in Palm Beach County. But now is not the time for the people down here in Congressional District 18 to be left in a lurch.
Speaking of soon-to-be ex-Congressman West, he is perhaps most infamous for having claimed that about 80 Democrats in Congress were in fact communists. While looking for an appropriate clip for this segment, I came across the following gem in which he explains what he means by the word communist.
When you said that the Congressional Progressive Caucus had 70 or so communists, do you have any regrets about that?
No, I don't regret it whatsoever. We understand that at the turn of the century, American communists renamed themselves as progressives. If you study the Woodrow Wilson administration, people refer to the Woodrow Wilson administration as a progressive administration.
Woodrow Wilson. So, in Alan West's fetid little brain, President Woodrow Wilson was a communist because his administration accomplished the following. The Federal Reserve Act, the Revenue Act, the Federal Trade Commission Act, and the Clayton Antitrust Act all had to do with banking and tariff reform, the establishment of a federal income tax, and prevention of corporate monopolies. The Keating-Owen Child Labor Act curtailed child labor in America. The Federal Farm Loan Act and the Smith-Lever Act promoted and protected agriculture in America. The Adamson Act established an 8-hour workday for railway workers. And, of course, the 17th Amendment established the election of senators by popular vote. Isn't that a radical agenda? Now, by implication, pretty much any president who has ever signed any legislation that provides for the health, safety, and welfare of citizens is a communist. And that pretty much includes every Democratic president since Wilson, and also such dyed-in-the-wool Bolsheviks as Theodore Roosevelt.
Charge! Charge the blockhouse!
Some of you have been wondering about Mungo, and he insists on being part of the action today. Can you find something else to do? Thank you very much. Okay then. I don't have proper dim bulb nominees today. Unfortunately, I haven't had much time to look for them, and you, the viewer, have not been sending me suggestions. So, I think it's high time we started thinking about the Dim Bulb of the Year competition. Just to remind you, last year's winner was Lord Christopher Monckton.
During the Australian leg of his climate speaking tour, Monckton compared an Australian government climate change advisor to Adolf Hitler.
The correct policy is to have the courage to do nothing.
I'm not a scientist. I mean, there's no point in mincing words about it. The Democratic Party is now essentially a communist party. As to whether anyone should listen to me, no.
And what follows are some of the potential nominees for Dim Bulb of the Year for 2012.
Thank you.
Have the month of December to go, so we'll add a couple more dim bulbs of the week before the end. And this year I'm going to do something different. We had some real quality nominees in 2012 who weren't actually selected as dim bulb of the week, and I believe I'm going to give some of them another shot. For example, Representative Paul Brown of Georgia was a crowd favorite. And we will select the dim bulb of the year based on popular vote. There will be a gold, silver, and bronze medal winner. And around about January 1st, I will do a highlight reel that features the best scenes for all the dim bulb nominees. So I hope you enjoy that. Before I go, I just want to say I am really looking forward to the new Hobbit movie. I hope it lives up to its predecessors, the Lord of the Rings films. The other day I decided I was going to reread The Hobbit for the first time in maybe 3 decades. My old copy is long gone, so I bought this beautiful new copy with illustrations by Alan Lee. And it was a much more enjoyable read than I recall. And finally, a word about football. First of all, I want to congratulate the University of North Carolina women's soccer team. They're going to the Final Four again. That program has won 20 national championships, and in college sports, that's unprecedented. And as for yesterday's matches, I saw the good, the bad, and the ugly. I watched quite a bit of football yesterday morning. It started quite early here. And in terms of beautiful football, I can't imagine a better performance than Bayern Munich's performance yesterday. In terms of bad football, I don't think you can do much worse than Motherwell versus Hearts, two teams that seemed unable to string more than 2 passes together. And as for the ugly, there's the Fulham-Stoke match. Now, I'm not complaining, and I'm not bitter, but it's impossible to play beautiful football against Stoke. As a matter of fact, I would say a Stoke match is not so much a football match as an extended mugging. Bis später.